Welcome back to part 7.2. This is the continuation of the history functionality. So, obviously, we don't want to draw multiple tiles in the form of a rectangle, only to undo this for every single tile. The problem we have is that a building history item is not equal to one step when drawing, because a drawing step can include multiple positions and multiple previous tiles, and in consideration of the deleting tool, also several maps. So, let's add a new class we call BuildingHistoryStep, which will function as a wrapper around multiple items. The only variable here is an array of BuildingHistoryItem. We will create a constructor, which will take the elements one item needs, but everything as arrays, so that every item has its own pair of variables. Initialize the array with the length of the position array. Now we create a for loop based on the length of this array. Inside the loop, we will now create a new object of type BuildingHistoryItem and add its value to the array. Everything uses the loop variable I as index. One step can now contain as many single items as needed. To make your life a little bit easier, copy the constructor but change the tilemaps array to a single tilemap. When drawing with the default tool, we only can draw on one tilemap. With this constructor, we don't have to create an array full of the same tilemap. Now again, we create two public methods, undo and redo. All we need to do is now is looping through all entries in the history items array and call the according method for every element. Taking a look in the BuildingCreator script, the drawItem method gets called for every tile inside a rectangle or line. So we need to make some changes here. For now, let's just ignore the tooling part. We will deal with it last. The position is the only thing that must be expanded. Let's make it an array and enjoy the errors. I also rename it to positions. Let's deal with the calls from the drawBounds method first. Instead of calling this method every time, we only call it once. We will use the two for loops to generate all the positions inside the bounds and save them to this list. And because I'm too lazy for the math, we use a list and then convert it into an array. Yeah, everyone hates arrays. We call this method once more here, for every single click event. The position is also a single value, but I don't want to convert it here. It does not make sense at this place. But thanks to method overloading, we have an alternative. By creating several methods with the same name but different parameters, C# can distinct which one you want to call based on the parameter types. In this case, we change positions to a single position value. Inside this method, we then create an vector3 int array and use position as the only value. Now we can call the draw item again. So this line here, we'll call this method here. Let's get rid of this else if statement and wrap it directly around the set tile. We now need two arrays of tile bases, one for the previous tiles and one for the new ones. Both arrays have the size of the positions array. With a for loop, we can now iterate through positions while knowing the index. At first, set the previous tile. Then we will check if the placement is forbidden. If not, we will save the tile base as new tile and then call set tile. But if the placement is forbidden, we will use the previous tile for the new tile. That makes sure that no modifying will happen at this position. At the end of this else statement, we create the building history step with the new array values and add it to the building history. Of course, this will give us a new error because it still wants a building item. So let's update this. Here we are simply going to replace the item types with the step types. And nothing should be read anymore. When testing, you should now be able to undo and redo the whole rectangle or line you have drawn. It even works when there are placement restrictions. Unfortunately, our deleting tool won't do anything, which is obvious with the code being commented out. So let's solve this final problem. So remember, we call the use method of the building tool. I think in most IDEs you should be able to hold Ctrl and click on the type to jump to its definition. Here we check for the type and call the according method of the tool controller. Since the eraser is my only tool, I will show the new handling only for this one. But if one of your tools wants to use the history, you can apply this approach as well. Besides the return value a method can have, which is here just void, so nothing, a method can also pass other variables back to the caller. This is done with so-called out parameters, and it's a C# feature, if you want to Google it. Every tool might have a different history handling. That's why every tool will handle it on its own. In the eraser case, the previous tile can have a value, but the new tile is always null. And we also delete on several maps. Go back to your building creator and uncomment the code. We want to pass a single position, but only have an array. We could now loop through this array and call the use method for every entry, but we will update the use behavior to support arrays. On one side, this fits the current drawing flow better, which relies on a position array, and on the other side, it gives the tool more use cases when it knows the whole building array instead of just one position at a time. Let's just imagine a room planning tool. It is like a rectangle tool, but it will only draw the outlines of this room. With just one tile at a time, this would not be possible. So let's set positions as parameter and go to the building tool script. Here we make the parameter an array and rename it to represent a plural. In your tool controller, do the same thing. Now we have the array of the positions and are able to create a full building history step, which could contain multiple building history items. We will store the items in a list and save them as a step later. Since we have multiple positions now, we need to loop through them. We don't need the index here, so we can use a for each loop. Create an item with a value of null. Then there is the process where we check if any tile map has something drawn onto it for the given position and delete it if so. This is the place in code where we will instantiate the item. Because if nothing has been found there, there is no need for history, because nothing happened. We create a new building history item like we did at the beginning of this tutorial. And the new tile will be null because it will be a deleted tile. After the any method, we will check if item is not null. Then we can add it to the list we created at the top of this eraser method, so we only keep relevant data in the memory. At the end of the method, we need to assign a value to our out variable. But we already have a list of history items, so we don't want to pass in multiple arrays. For this, we will add a new constructor. It will just take an array of items and assign it to its variable. Now we can pass items to array as parameter to the constructor, and all errors should be gone. Well, at least in this file. Go back to your building tool. There's an error with the eraser method, because it requires the out parameter to be available. So let's add it. And keeping it here would not make any sense. So we add the same parameter to this use method and assign the one from the eraser to it. In cases of tools without history, just the default case, we still need to give the step a value. So we need to add a line where we assign it to null. And the eraser can just override the value. One done and a new one read. Let's switch, finally, back to the building creator. Here we need to add this out parameter as well. and this is also where we want it to be. This value can either be an object or it is null, if we don't have any history for this tool. So let's check if it is not null. And if it is not, we can just add it to the building history. And... whoa! Now this is a nice undoReader tool. The eraser tool behaves like we want it to. And based on the code I showed, you should be able to adapt it to your needs for other tools. Now, just one thing. The buttons, yeah. Go to your building history. We will create two public variables with expression bodies as values. This is like creating a getter, just shorter. The first one will tell us if we can undo a step, and the second if we can redo. Both should have a capital first letter, which I obviously did wrong. Now, in the history handler, the one that is responsible for the buttons, we create a new method. The first parameter will tell us if the given button should be interactable or not. The method then sets the button to the state, if the state is not already the same. And in the update function, we can call this method now for both buttons, with the corresponding variable from the building history. The buttons are now grayed out when you can't use them, so the user knows when they can undo or redo steps. And we are at the end. Like I said, this history is only available during one game session, which is the default behavior for most games. But if you want more, you can combine my tutorials about storing data and the Building History Step class to even save your whole history into a file. But this is definitely too edge casey to show it in a tutorial, yeah? Thank you for watching, and also thank you to everyone supporting me and the channel. Special thanks to my supporters on Patreon, Patrick and NexVomo. Thank you all. And as usual, if you enjoyed the content, consider liking and subscribing. And I'll see you next time.